spiritual health and welcome. And this is Kerr along with Kerr. Kerr is a member of the Interfaith Center, and we have met before, but I don't know much about her in terms of an introduction, so I'm sorry about that. I was going to sit sort of over here so I can try to listen to the doorbell, so that's why I'll be farther away.
Okay.
And I know you're the treasurer of the Edmonton Society.
I'm not, I'm president.
The president.
That's okay, I've got my, I'll introduce myself.
Okay. It was a mix up because your
Yes, our PayPal account is set for treasurer, so all the emails were going to my treasurer instead of me, so I didn't know what
anything
was going on.
So thank you,
Kerr. Suddenly, we realized. So we're going to start, I guess, is everybody here? All the important people are here, right? Everyone that's important is here?
Yes.
Okay. So as Nana said, my name is Karen. I'm the president of the Society of Edmonton Atheists. I'm actually also the co-founder of a province-wide conference called Alberta Secular Conference. Our next one will be next year. It's interesting because it's slightly different than being focused on atheism. We deal with secular issues. So last year we had Catholics come and speak. We had Christians. Next year we are going to do probably a day to do with Muslims and things like that as well. So it's not necessarily atheist in its entirety. So yeah, that's something else I'm involved with. I've been in the group for 5 years. I lived in Scotland for 10 years, and when I came back, you know, friends move on, we were kids, we were all in different stages of our lives, so I decided I needed a community of people that felt the same way about things as I did, so I went out looking, and there was already a Society of Edmonton Atheists in the city. If there hadn't been, I don't think I would have created one. and so when I joined them, I became the vice president within 6 months, and then the year after that, I was voted in as president. So I'm on my fourth term currently as the president of the society, my fourth year. So I'm going to get started with a few definitions. Some of these might seem obvious, you already know them, but just so we all have the same starting point, I thought we could define a few words, and then we can move on from there so that if you hear me say that word, you know what it is exactly that I mean, because everyone can slightly have different definitions of things sometimes. Or the colloquial version of it is used instead of what it originally meant, because words change over time. So, a theist. A theist is someone who believes in a god or gods. It can be more specifically defined sometimes to be someone that believes in a personal god. So someone that thinks that God intervenes and interacts with us. Some people do have a sticking point with that, but that's why you get words like deist, who would maybe not think that God interacts, but maybe did still start everything. So there's different types of views inside that. For our purposes, it's not really that important, other than the belief in God is really the main stickler for us for what a theist would be in regards to the atheist, which is the opposite, obviously. It's not that we have a belief there is no God, which a lot of people confuse. So you believe there's no God? It's not a belief. I have a lack of belief. It's actually a complete opposite. People kind of get that confused. Basically, all that means is the evidence that's been presented to me by any various faith doesn't convince me. So if someone brought me a brand new argument tomorrow that convinced me, I'd be a theist tomorrow. So that's the distinction I wanted to make, because it can change how you view things. Yes, so I'm gonna have to. Oh, it's updating stuff. I'll just have to do it manually. Right. So a skeptic is a word that you might hear quite often. A lot of people just think this just is a cynic. They doubt everything. Kind of. It's not so cynical as it is doubting, but it's doubting until you've gathered all your information. So it's just withholding a conclusion at this point. So when evidence is presented to me for anything, let's say something shows up on Facebook and they'll tell me something, I'll go and actually try and disprove it first. I'll go and find the other opposite side, and then I can balance both sides before I come to a conclusion on something. So that's what skeptic really means. So you're looking for evidence and you look at all the available arguments before you come to your conclusion. Naturalist is sometimes thrown around to mean atheist, not a naturist, not someone that's naked all the time. Naturalist or materialist. So we're looking for the answers for things in nature. So these are natural answers to things. We don't look to a supernatural instead. Other terms you might hear, pretty much every atheist I know that's in our group, if you really ask them to define themselves specifically, will tell you they're an agnostic atheist. I think if we're really true to all of ourselves, we're all agnostic in a way, because agnostic is a truth claim of knowledge. None of us really know what happened to start the universe, but we have ideas about how that happened, but we can't 100% prove any of our worldviews. So if we're honest with ourselves, we are all agnostic, we just fall either way of the spectrum there. So I am an agnostic atheist. You might hear the words free thinker, humanist, secular humanist, non-theist, non-religious. People use all sorts of different labels to describe themselves. My mother and I actually were just having a discussion about the differences within atheism and the different atheists she's met at my various events. And I said, but we're just like any other group. Within Christians, you've got people that are completely fundamental Christians, you've got liberal Christians on the other side, you've got a full range of people, but they all still believe in Jesus. So we're no different than any other group. We have a wide range of how much you accept things or don't accept things, or, you know, differences between all of us.
It's just human nature, I guess.
Sorry about this.
It's because it's updating, I can't just scroll through it, unfortunately.
So I wanted to bring up secularism. We actually just had a roundtable meeting for my group last week, and we talked about some of the more religious movies that have been coming out recently, a dramatic uptick in how many religious movies have been coming out. And the difference from like the Ten Commandments, Days of Ben-Hur, those were entertainment, Hollywood big movies. But we've been noticing a lot of proselytizing type movies now, like God's Not Dead, God's Not Dead 2. And I wanted to, we kind of looked into that. Something I noted in all of them was they were using the word secular to mean atheist. But secular has nothing to do with atheism. We obviously embrace secularism, but I know secular Jews, I know secular Christians, Catholics, Muslims, Hindus, every religion have people within their group that are secular. Because all secular really means is keeping your religion out of public life. So keeping it away from the government buildings, and when you're creating laws, you're not favoring one religion over another. Separation of church and state, we hear that in the States all the time. That means secular. So when you're keeping your religion and your church and your school just teaches math, it doesn't teach all the rest of, you know, the religions on top of it as well. So you certainly can be religious and secular. And this is actually the best method to help protect everyone's freedoms. We have a charter right, freedom of religion, which the Supreme Court ruled means freedom from religion as well. And we all have that basic right. So the only way to protect that for all of us is to make sure that one isn't favored over another. So we can't make laws based on the Hindu books, because then that would be favoring that religion over the rest of us. So I'm not sure what kind of group we have here. As far, I kind of assume that being an interfaith group and wanting to get along, we all kind of fall into this category. But I just wanted to make sure that we realize it's not, it doesn't equal atheist at all.
Right.
It's something separate. Right, so the big questions and how atheism deals with them. I get it's a lot. I think we've met a few times at the Festival of Faith event that John Humphrey's kids put on, and these are generally the questions that we get. So obviously religion also tries to answer these big questions. So I'm going to give you the atheist answers to some of them. So we'll deal with how did life begin, origins of life, how the universe came about, what about morals, what's the meaning of life, and then I've got a little slide with a few extra common questions. Some of them you might laugh at, because they seem ridiculous at the face of them, but some people, if they haven't really researched outside of their own worldview, it's a genuine question on their part, they just don't understand that it was a bit silly. Until I answer it, and then they're like, oh, okay, sorry. we'll get through those. So, how did life begin? I find this one is quite confusing for some people if they haven't actually studied it in school, so it'll depend on how we were brought up. But there's a really important distinction to make here. One is the origin of life, and then one is the theory that deals with how life became so diverse on our planet. A lot of people think evolution encompasses the first part. A biogenesis is the name of dealing with the origins of life. So this actually holds that RNA, we used to think it was DNA that was the start of life, but now scientists have discovered that RNA is simpler but also helps hold the building blocks. So ribonucleic acid, and it's the building block of life, and it formed naturally. As I said, we're naturalists, we look for natural answers. Naturally in the chemicals that would have been available on early Earth. So there's been plenty of laboratory experiments over the years, and many of them failed, or they managed to put two chemicals together, but it was synthesized. Like, it wouldn't have been what Earth looked like, so how would that have worked? Just recently, we've managed to reproduce two of the four chemical bases. There's the four of them required for RNA in completely natural methods. I think it was in the UK, it was 2011, they won some big huge research grant because of it. They managed to create one by simply putting the chemicals together sort of in a stagnant pool, and then it evaporated, and when it came back down as rain, it made a reaction. Then when they put UV light on it, the sun, it turned into another one, some of them. So they got a two for one, this was a joke. There's a really great, I think I have it up later on as a recommended, but there's actually a NOVA series from PBS called The Origins of Life, and they talk about that particular science. It's super interesting, and they really make it easy to understand because they talk about a recipe and how if you know the ingredients but you don't know how to cook them properly in the right order, then you might not end up with anything. So it kind of compares it, gives a good analogy. So that's the biogenesis. And we have evolution. So this is separate. And I find it interesting, again, that some people will not even research this because they expect it to include the other part. But we're not dealing with the origin of life anymore. So it doesn't conflict, actually, with ideas. God could certainly have been involved in starting this off, if that's what you want to believe. So evolution. So this is how, after life is obviously created, where we go from there. The diverseness of creatures we see on the Earth is explained through this. There's a great analogy in a Dawkins book, long before he became quite controversial, but it talks about how if you had a daughter, a mother, and a grandmother, and you had pictures of them all, if you looked at them, you could see how they were similar, but they're not identical. There's small changes that happen generation upon generation. When you're dealing with evolution, you've got a huge time frame. So it's not one big jump forward all of a sudden, it's just lots and lots and lots of little changes that take place over time, and eventually you end up with something that looks nothing like what the start was. So that's how we explain evolution. And obviously there's lots and lots of things more than just fossils. A lot of people think it's just fossils that support this theory, but there's loads more sciences that do. Okay. Oh, what did they do? I wasn't even touching it. Yeah, we're on pause for a minute, and it's redoing all those things. Okay, so I'll talk about what was up there. Embryology, so when we study the embryos of different animals, we see lots of striking similarities. A great example is fish, reptiles, birds, mammals, all of our embryos look exactly the same at the very, very start. And we all actually have slits for gills. But it's only the fish that keep them. The rest of us have that turned into something else. On humans, it becomes part of our jaw and our ears. And I know I watched a documentary once where there was one lady who actually still had the tiniest little slit right behind her ear. So it's like a throwback. Some people have more webbing in between their fingers than others of us. So there's lots of little clues that you can see that connects us to our ancestral, common ancestors. Comparative anatomy, so this actually predates evolution. Of course, when we were learning about how to take care of our bodies and medicine and things was starting to come about, they had to study our bodies. You can see similar structures inside various animal species, things that we share with other species. Again, I'm just going to talk about our hands. If you look at fish, you can see these bones inside their fins, but they just don't become our hand. But in us, that same gene becomes a hand. So we can see how we're linked to that. Biogeology, so this is where animals live and how different traits can arise in different areas of the world. So we only have marsupials in Australia, I think most of us know that. And so we'd expect to see this with evolution because the climate or other natural pressures of the area would cause things, different things to be naturally selected. Otherwise, we'd expect to see them everywhere around the Earth. Paleontology is obviously the fossil record. We have lots of transitional forms. Lots of people ask me, well, show me one transitional form, but you could actually argue that if you take the grandmother, granddaughter, mother analogy, every single fossil we find is transitional. Every single one. But we do have specific ones that show different types changing. So we've got the Tiktaalik, which shows the transition of fish to a tetrapod. We've got the Archaeopteryx, which shows dinosaurs into birds. They actually have feathers, so you can see the differences there. And there's a rich fossil record that shows the rise of us from apes into human. Biochemistry, that's the DNA and the RNA. I'm pretty sure most of us at this stage would know that we share DNA even down to bananas. I think they have like 50% the same DNA as us. And obviously the higher up species, the great apes, share the most DNA with us. Chimps at 90%, pretty similar. Microbiology deals with genes and how they can be turned off and on to change and create new things in different species. So fish have a gene that if you turn it on or mutate it, it'll actually make them grow more fins. In us, we'll grow more fingers, but it's the exact same gene. So you can see how they're linked. Geology, the fossil record's kept in certain layers of the rock. But if we found a modern day rabbit, for example, way down at the bottom where we didn't expect it, that would throw evolution right out the window. That's never happened. They're always exactly where you expect them to be within the fossil record and within the rocks. Observable, in labs we've actually been able to observe evolutionary changes, fruit flies, bacteria become resistant to antibiotics. And even in humans we have some examples. My mother falls into this category. She's not Chinese. 30% of the Chinese population no longer have wisdom teeth. We've been taking them out for generations, and I guess they just evolved to just, well, why bother? Why bother having them in the first place? My mother never got them. She never had tonsils. We've always joked maybe she didn't have an appendix. So she's an evolutionary throw forward, and I'm not sure why it's China in particular. There is some theories. Because of the size of our jaws became smaller than primates to let our brains get bigger, which is why we have slightly higher IQs. And the trade-off for losing the wisdom teeth that they found is that these people have a couple of more IQ points. Not that a couple more IQ points makes a difference, but when you got a couple more for that, a couple more for your sightedness, and a couple more, then it can make a difference. So that might be why it's favored. In sub-Saharan Africa, we've actually got people who are developing resistance to HIV. So they can catch HIV, but they don't get sick from it, and they never get AIDS. Chimps have already done that. Wild chimps already have protection against SIV, which is the exact same disease, just simian. So I find that interesting. We're actually behind them. Chimps have got us beaten. Okay, so I don't know. I don't have the login, so I guess I can't show the rest of my slides. But she had to come in. Is a password or not.
Okay.
Okay, updated. So recommended viewing and reading if you don't have an understanding of these things or you're interested in it. As I said, The Origin of Life, the NOVA, and that's on pbs.org. It's Neil deGrasse Tyson that presents that one. So it's a few years old now, but still very relevant. And books, there's one called Your Inner Fish by Neil Shupin. You guys might remember because it was actually a miniseries on PBS a few years ago. And that was where I got the information about the lady that had the little slit behind her ear. So he goes and shows you all the different areas that are linked to our common ancestors before. It's a fascinating read. If you would prefer not to watch an atheist or read a book by an atheist, there is a book by Francis S. Collins, who is a Christian. He ran the Genome Project, and he has a book called The Language of God. And that shows how all our DNA is connected to our past ancestors. So there's some ideas where if you want to look at those. So the next one was, how did the universe start? Atheists, pretty much, I think I've only met one that didn't accept the Big Bang Theory. Most of us do. It's the best model we have based on the current evidence. Something tomorrow might be discovered that'll throw it out of whack, but that's fine. As far as first cause, though, this is where we differ. Obviously, religions will tell you that it was God that was the first cause of the universe, whereas we say we don't know. And as far as we're concerned, it's actually okay to say we don't know. We'll figure it out. Just because we don't know yet doesn't mean we might not in the future. There's a few different theories on this, though. Multiverse theory is one that's quite common right now, getting thrown about, where they think there's
infinite numbers of different multiverses that all have different things inside of them, so there might be life on one, there might not be life on another, different laws of nature, things like that. I don't really get that one, it confuses me. I prefer the black hole theory, where black holes, we know that they suck in energy and light, that eventually it sucks in everything and then just explodes again, which, as my father pointed out, could still count as a multiverse, but it's just the multiverse, only one exists at a time. So I was like, okay, I guess I could get that. My parents are Christian, by the way, just in case you're wondering. When I say they're very liberal and very much science-minded, so the Bible is there to teach us some stories, but they don't take anything in it literally other than the resurrection. But
hey, thank you.
That's very good.
Okay, let's see what slide I'm on. We're almost at the end already. Right, so this is a common question we face. How can you have morals if you don't believe in God? I believe, and I think most of us hold to an evolutionary standpoint with morals, that they came up with us. And there's plenty of... There's plenty of evidence and research showing that animals do have types of moral codes within their structures. So the building blocks required to make moral societies are existent in our common ancestors. Empathy, emotion, I can't say that word, reciprocity?
Yeah.
Okay. memory of actions that have happened in the past, so then you can hold a grudge or you can reward someone. That's why memory is in there. Gratitude. So rats, even elephants, dolphins, primates, they've all shown that they hold all of these in experiments. So, great book to read, Our Inner Ape by Franz De Waal. Probably top of my list, right? I just finished it for our book club, but it's fascinating. He has so many stories, he's kind of top of the list. So many stories of things that he's watched inside different groups of chimpanzees, gorillas, orangutans, all that, and fascinating to see how much of a life them is actually a little scary sometimes. But he says these animals may not know the golden rule, but they do seem to follow it, which is quite interesting. So that's where I stand on morals. There's a few atheists that have different philosophies on morals, so you'll have to ask each of us, but I think the majority of my group hold to the evolutionary viewpoint of it that it came up with us. So we don't hold to a divine purpose, we don't hold to destiny or fate. We create our own purpose and meaning for life ourselves. How do we do this? Exactly the same way you do. Relationships, love, we're passionate about something, we explore it, kindness, friendship, all those things that all of us do. We're social creatures, so that's how we find a purpose in life. Life is valuable for its own sake, meaning the purpose comes not from above, but from within. So there's that book, Dan Barker used to be a minister down in the States somewhere, who is now, he's one of the founders of the Freedom From Religion organization in the States, and he wrote a book called Life and Purpose. So it talks about having meaning as an atheist opposed to when he was a theist. Am I talking too fast?
No, I think I'm okay. I think you're perfect.
Okay. Do atheists believe in an afterlife? This is an intriguing question. I'm an atheist, my sister is an atheist. I'm a skeptic, my sister is not. She has moved out of a house because she thought it was haunted. She believes in an afterlife. She believes in healing power of crystals. So she's definitely a different type of atheist I am, but we both don't believe in a God. So that, under the umbrella of atheism, we both fit. But when we get down to details, we're different. So it really depends on what kind of atheist you meet. Most people that come from a theist background and then become an atheist have done through being a skeptic. So those people won't believe in an afterlife. But my sister and I, as much as my parents are Christian, they weren't active in their church when we were growing up, so we didn't go to church. We went to public schools, we didn't pray before we ate. There was never any sort of influence of religion over us. Secular, as it were, just nothing, it was neutral, right? But that meant we didn't have any really reason to be skeptical about religion because we didn't grow up inside it, so she took a different route.
So she hasn't done the skeptic side, whereas I have.
There's no reliable evidence to support an afterlife or supernatural mankind. Some of you might argue near-death experience, things like that, but there are some neuroscience has shown that we can actually imitate near-death experiences even when the person's not dead at all. So again, I balance all the evidence to, yeah.
So, do you want the question now or at the end?
Go ahead.
Well, your sister must believe in a soul, and an immortal soul then.
We've had this kind of conversation. I actually just don't think she's thought about it, to be honest. Yeah. She doesn't really, it's not interesting to her.
Yeah.
She's off doing other things. She likes to go hiking in the mountains. That's more important to her than having big theological conversations.
And not all of our beliefs are logical. Many of us would believe in things that may not be logical at all.
Yeah. Even atheists. Which was kind of my point here. Sometimes there might be, you have your own biases, right, for how your environment raises you. So it can be different. So in my group, you'll mostly find atheists that don't believe in an afterlife. But you may encounter atheists out there in the world that'll sit and have a chat about ghost stories with you and won't have any sort of problem with that conversation. So again, on the spectrum. So some other common questions we get. Do you believe in Satan? Do you worship Satan? Now, I kind of hoped you'd laugh after I told you what he thinks of me, but I guess not. This is supernatural. And in order to believe in an evil source, like devil or Satan or whatever you want to call that, you've also got to believe in God. So it's actually only theists that subscribe to a Satan or devil world, not us. So no, how can I worship something I don't think exists? Ghosts kind of touched on that one already, so most of us don't. There are exceptions, like my sister. Do you hate God? We get this one quite a lot, actually, I know. I find it a silly question, but again, it's just someone that hasn't perhaps thought it through, what they're asking. If lightning struck your house and burnt it down to a crisp, would you be mad at Zeus? That's how I feel. I don't believe there is such an entity as God, so how can I hate it? How can I be angry at it if it's not there, it doesn't exist? So I can't hate God any more than you could hate Thor. Is atheism a religion? It's not. Religion needs a higher power as part of its tenets. So we don't fall into that section. It's a lack of religion. It's the exact opposite of one. But because I think we deal with the big questions, the same questions that religion's trying to answer, I think that's why it belongs in the discussion, at least. I meant to look up demographics, but it's like 1 in 4 people are maybe not convinced of religion. I don't want to say atheist, but might say they're non-religious, as it were, don't belong to a church or whatever. So there's certainly a large demographic of people out there that need their voice heard when we're talking about that conversation. When did atheism start? Do we have any Hindus in the room? It's always Hindus that ask me that question. I don't know if that's because their claim is they're the oldest religion. I don't know if that's why they want to know. But we don't really have a date. We're not a religion. We don't have a book to follow. So there isn't like a date when I can tell you the first atheist was on Earth. But you can see people that were critiquing religion all the way back for as long as we've been able to read and write. My personal theory on this is that as soon as somebody said, I believe in fill in the blank, somebody said, well, I don't. So I think as long as there's been a theist, there's been an atheist. There is a slight difference with what people might think is like the uprise of atheism, which lots of people call new atheists. Now, we're not new. We've been around for forever. I mean, the Enlightenment period was full of atheists. But after 9/11, I think just generally a lot of people became critical of religion and the good it could bring and the bad it could bring. And so I think that some people have linked that to be when atheism started, but that's not the truth. Obviously, an increase of information on the internet as well, since the internet's become available, has also increased the amount of people willing to say they're atheists. So it might look like there's more of us now, or that it's like a new movement, but it has always been around. And then I quite often get this question, why do we feel the need for a group? Sometimes some people will try to be condescending to that. They'll say, well, why do you need to gather to celebrate your non-belief? But why does anybody join a group? Why do you go to book club? Why do you go to bowling club? They don't even need to be to do with religion. It's because we're social creatures. We need contact with other humans and we enjoy community. That's our main reason for existing, but there's also a requirement for it. Just like LGBT youth, when they maybe come out to their family, they can be expelled. Atheists go through that too. A lot of people get kicked out of their house, feel lonely, so they need to find a group of friends to help them through that. And we don't offer counseling. We do have a few people that can recommend counselors, secular counselors, but we don't offer that, but we do offer friendship and a place to come and feel like you can have your ideas heard. So, of course there's a need for an atheist group. I'm just going to talk about the sea for a little bit. So the SEA, Society of Edmonton Atheists, it was founded in 2008, so before I was here, and mostly it was just a social group. They sort of started out by meeting in a pub once a month and drinking. That was all they did, had conversations. We grew from there. When I joined, they had that and they had a breakfast. And again, I came back from being away for 10 years and really felt I needed to create friends. You don't make friends if you only see them once a month. So I'm like, no, we need to do more. So we started adding events. And now we have got an event on every single week, sometimes midweek, sometimes at the weekend. And it's varied. So you might not want to read a book every month, so I'll just go to a book club. There's a coffee night instead, I'll go to that. So we've got a very varied, diverse kind of events that you can choose from. Learning opportunities, as I said, there's the book club. We've cheekily called it counter-apologetics as a play on words of the apologetics movement. But basically what we do is we get together and we learn some of the arguments that are used for religion, from all the religions, and we examine the evidence. So that's us being skeptics at that event. We're looking at both sides of the coin. We have a monthly roundtable, so we kept that one, where we have guest speakers or we do topics of interest. As I said, last month we did the rise of religious movies and what that means. We sometimes go to museums, things like that. We have social events, we do solstice parties, we have pub nights, coffee nights, there's a family breakfast event once a month. We also have potluck events on various occasions. Take part in Pride Parade every year, so I'm glad we got our approval just this week too, so that's good. Philanthropic, we've done Habitat for Humanity quite a few years in a row, which some people find interesting because it's a Christian organization. But they're secular at the same time. Just because it was a bunch of Christians that started, it doesn't mean that the houses are open to anybody of any religion. There's no, it's only for these types of people. So we volunteered with them quite regularly. We haven't set up our date this year yet, but we'll get on that. Maybe when Jimmy Carter's here. You guys will know he's coming in June. highway cleanup. We sponsor a stretch of highway near NISQ, so we have to go out and do that a couple times a year as part of our contract.
I've seen the signs.
You have? It got stolen last year.
No.
Probably an atheist wanted it for their wall. I don't know. It got stolen. Anyway, we've got a new one up there. So we do that, and then we also do donation drives to food bank. Tools for School is a good one for us, because obviously education is important and something high on our list. We've done holiday hampers with the city in the past. And outreach, obviously, events like this. For me personally, I'm quite interested in changing the negative connotations that go with the word atheist. I'm shocked sometimes that people can have that. A festival faced the first year, I remember a lady walked all the way around, and when she got to her table, she just walked right around us and kept on going. And I thought, I'm not going to bite you. Not unless you ask me to, but it was interesting to me, and I think there can be some negative feelings around just the word atheist. So that's why I use that label loudly and proudly. Some people prefer secular humanists because they're too scared of the reactions they might get. But I think, no, I'm going to change the perception of this. If you meet me, I'm a mom, I've got kids, I'm busy in the community, I'm helping, and it kind of can throw some of your stereotypes upside down, hopefully. So we participate in festival faiths, we bring in speakers that are open to the public, we engage in conversations, we do debates at colleges and universities, and obviously now we belong to the Interfaith Society as well, so these are important to me. So that's the SEA. So I don't know where you want to go, if you want any questions.
Please. You think atheism is a belief?
Yes. No, it's a lack of a belief. Yeah, and I find it interesting too, because some people, I've had Pascal's wager, why not just believe? I actually can't.
But you're persuaded that you, what you don't believe is right. Isn't that a belief?
No, I'm the opposite of that. I'm not persuaded by religion's information, by their arguments.
But you're persuaded by the opposite then.
I'm neutral to it.
You're right.
I'm neutral to it. So I don't know, unless you want to say that evolution is a belief, which I don't personally hold to that. I think I understand evolution, so accept it. I don't think it's a belief system. I don't think it's an ideology. It can get a little bit confusing because you've got philosophy sort of ideologies here, and then you've got science, and the two don't necessarily conflict or overlap. There's two separate things. Science doesn't have a way to test these things. This doesn't necessarily fall into that category either. So I think atheism is just the neutral but accepting the science. But I don't hold an ideology as much as a it's kind of complicated, isn't it?
It is an ideology.
I don't feel that way. I feel that it's just I'm not persuaded by the evidences that people with the ideologies
but
give
we're,
me.
But we're persuaded for the same reason about atheism. So, I mean, it's both sides.
Yes, if you want to see it that way. That's not how I perceive it, but...
Without being an expert, I'm a little bit different on that account, but if my impression is that both Buddhism and some divisions of Buddhism are atheistic in their problem.
They can, but yes. We do
I wonder what your relationship is to these, what one would normally call religions, but without God.
Right. So I think Jainism is one that doesn't have a higher power. We do have a couple of Buddhists that come to our group. Not regularly, but once in a while we'll pop their head in. I think one of them lives quite far out of town. So they are kind of compatible. Buddhists can fall into two categories as well, because there are some that believe more in higher power stuff than, so it depends on what the branch of Buddhism is, like every other religion. You've got lots of different sects, right? But yes, I know the Dalai Lama a few years ago now was on record saying if science changed, if something we discovered in science didn't fit in with Buddhism, Buddhism would have to change to fit in with what the new facts were. So, and that just basically is saying your interpretation of what you read in the Holy Book was wrong. Science has proved you've got to fix your interpretation. So, yeah, I think there's a little bit more in common with definitely those kind of ideas of philosophies, I guess you want to call them. Yeah.
Anyone else? Well, I have a question and a comment. Mm-hmm. The new atheists, as you call them, the Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens, and I've read a few of their books and skimmed them. And what I'm really amazed at is how angry they are. They are hate-filled people. They hate religion and they hate religious people, and they say some terrible things about that really punitive things. And of course, you can always take the worst of any religion. You can look at Islam, and you can look at a bunch of girls who burned to death in a school because the security guards won't let them leave because they don't have their heads covered, and that is Islam. You can find horrible, hateful things about any of our faiths. And these new, angry atheists have hooked on that, and I think they're giving atheism a really bad name.
I think it's important to remember when those books were written. God Is Not Great and God Delusion both came out in 2003. So we're talking an immediate reaction to 9/11.
True.
And people tend to go that route. Yeah. You have anger first, is your first emotion to things. So I think those books were written when they were really angry. you can be angry about the parts of religion that suck without.
Sure.
I know the World Religions Conference in Red Deer, probably 3-4 years ago now, the topic of discussion was, is religion a source for good or evil in the world? And they had a Muslim, a Christian, a Jewish lady there, I believe, Hindu, and then they'd asked us to go. And all of them got up and only talked about the good in their religion. That's all they talked about. And I got up and I said, so the topic of conversation is religion a source for good or evil in the world? And the answer is yes.
Yeah.
And everyone clapped because they got it. And I was the only one honest enough to answer the question. And I showed two examples of good things each religion has done, and two examples of bad things each religion. And I included atheism, even though we're not a religion, but we fit into the conversation. And so I showed two examples of charities and good things we've done, and two examples of, I got Stalin out of the way, that's what I did. So I didn't get questioned about it. Yeah, and I was the only one that got any media attention. So I think that you just have to take some time, you have to take the book in the context of when it was written. But yes, I find those books angry as well. But given the time period of when they were written, I kind of understand why they were angry.
Yeah, and you did mention 9/11. Well, many of us here go to interfaith conferences, a lot of interfaith conferences, and very, very often I am just amazed that people will stand up and they represent their religion and say, my religion believes in peace and love and it's perfect, and if everybody was just like us, there would be peace in the world. And they do not admit that their teachings have been distorted, that they're easily distorted, that they have
different interpretations from each person, not even necessarily
and that they have clergy who are the problem, and that they have clergy who are preaching the wrong thing. And I'm talking about all faiths. I'm talking about certainly the three monotheisms, all of them. The chief rabbi of Israel, I'm Jewish, comes out with things all the time that are just racist and hateful and horrible. So, and if we can't get to a point now where we can talk about the truth about these things, and the truth about our faiths, the good and the bad, and that's what the Interfaith Center has been trying to do for 22 years now, is say religion is not the problem, politics is the problem, human nature is the problem, and the people of faith need to stand up and say we want to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. But if you can't tell the truth, then what's the point?
And then you also have, there's different, again, like I said, like atheism, it's not like we all are exactly the same clone cut from each other. You've got all sorts of wide views inside that. And you also, I seem to see sort of like a circle that people go through when they leave their religion. They're always angry at the start, always angry. They feel they were lied to, or they feel like, you know, this part, well, we've got a few people in our group, a lady that was raised Jehovah's Witness whose mother died because she refused her blood transfusion. So she's always going to be angry about that, always. Her mother was taken from her. We have another lady that was Christian Science, the same thing. Her mother had diabetes, but they pray to heal. They don't accept medicine. Her mother died. So there's some anger that's always going to be there. But then you see people cycle through. They go through their anger phase, then they come to their accepting phase, then they realize we all got to live together phase, and then suddenly they're humanists. You kind of come out the other end. But some people take longer on that journey, just like all of us learn at different rates. They might die angry. They might never get out of that stage. But I do see that within our group. There's certainly different stages people can go through.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
I'm just curious, what were the two sources of evil that you mentioned at the Congress? Is it two, you chose two of them?
I know I talked about Stalin under an atheist regime, even though it wasn't in the name of atheism.
No.
And he really thought of himself as God, if we want to get down to it. He wanted himself being the almighty I. I can't remember what the other one was. I'm afraid. I'm sorry. It would have been something, another. It might have been, maybe the one in China when they were under communist rule and all those people died. It might have been that. Is that Pol Pot or?
Well, Pol Pot, but
the other one. One of those. It was probably one of those. Yeah.
Even Hitler was not a Christian.
I don't know what he was, because, he had the Catholic Church in his pocket, but that was for power. So it's so confusing, because he wrote things that were religious and he wrote things that were non-religious. I think Hitler was just Hitler, and we just all need to accept that he doesn't belong to any of us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, you did.
Me and my husband have had this discussion where, like, if my favorite color is blue, and his favorite color is green, why do we have to put so much significance on making each other wrong for liking a different color?
Right.
Right. We talk about that in regards to, like, religion. It's like what my personal belief is and what other people's personal beliefs are. If we're good people and we're doing things for the betterment of all mankind, who the heck cares?
And this is,
actions, and the way I look at it, you can judge a religion based by a couple people, but you wouldn't do that with race, you wouldn't do that with gender, you wouldn't. So why is it okay to say, well, those three Catholics there, or those that one Hindu means therefore all of it is evil, you know, with atheism. I never thought poorly, I actually never really knew much about it. I thought it was just, yeah, I don't believe God.
And I think the only reason that you really have sort of movement in the atheist community is for a long time they probably didn't do much. And there's plenty of, my husband's an atheist, he could care less about doing any sort of activism. It's only when people are saying, I have this belief and my favorite color is blue, therefore your favorite color needs to be blue. That's when we go, oh, hang on a minute here, I don't like blue. And that's why we have a pushback. It's only when people are trying to enforce their belief on everyone else that you've got an issue. And that brings us right back to secularism. So that's, you know, that's where our group in particular are having the fights, is within that world. But if you just want to believe in God and leave me to myself, then have at it. I don't know. Why would I have a problem with that?
Yeah. And I don't know God and all religions, but I don't know any religion that preaches hate towards another religion. All religions fundamentally are talking about.
Depends on your interpretation. People can use their interpretation to say, yes, my religion does tell me that, but that's
all
individual.
That tends to be more the personal interpretation of the religion itself, because I can read anything out of context.
If I recall, it's a Scientology. Sometimes I lose memory.
I was raised Christian Catholic.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's another thing people will find amusing about atheists. When you were saying you maybe don't know too much about some of the other religions, you know those tests you can take, they've done studies where they, you know, you have to answer all these questions about other religions. Atheists always come out on top. We always seem to know most about all the religions. But again, that's the skeptic side of us. That's us looking at all the evidence that's available before we come to our conclusions. So, I probably can answer some questions about other religions as well.
There's a distinct movement within the people that you call who believe in God. It's defining who God is.
Mm.
And I think that's a hinge over which a lot of quarreling and structures and beliefs emerge, is their definition of God. The trend in, at least in liberal Christianity, that God is not a person, God is love. So if you exercise your life through love, you are exercising what God wants you to be. And I think that's true for atheists as well.
And again, no problems with religions that hold those types of views. And why would we have a problem with that?
Yes,
so it is only the people and the groups that are trying to enforce their particular ways. But again, you'll find United Churches, Unitarian Churches, Buddhists, they're actually all on the same side as us. When you've got the Lord's Prayer in public schooling, in public schools in Alberta, which is protected, unfortunately, we'll need to get the Constitution changed if we want that protection removed. But when we've stood up against that, unfortunately, it's been the atheists that have taken the bad rap for it, but there's Muslims and Jewish people, and even other Christians, Jehovah's Witnesses, because they're not supposed to say the Lord's Prayer, all fighting with us behind the scenes. They just don't want to be publicly known. So I think that's the unfortunate part. Atheism takes the rap and the heat, but everybody actually wants the same thing. So it's kind of confusing from that point of view. And I think that can also be where some of the stereotypical angry atheists come from. But, you know, you need activists. So I guess we'll stand up and be the activists.
Part of the fear for the interfaith movement, too, is throwing out the baby in the bathwater with the bathwater, too, because we don't want, we want our educational activity protected, right? You know, like our display in City Hall. And I hate to ever have anybody challenge that and say, what? There's an interfaith display in City Hall, but that's a public space. You shouldn't have that. Whereas we say, well, it's education and it's fair. And,
well, and as long as it rotates through everything, that's the problem.
Exactly, yeah. But
it's when it's only one group there all the time, then you have an issue.
Then that would be wrong.
I'm not having an atheist display in City Hall.
Well, we've been chatting about that, right? So we've thought about that,
And we're hoping to.
We'll just have to get into the rotation. I need to see if my thing is up to date, because I think I bought it at the end of the term last year.
You joined with PayPal, as we were saying.
I will be in the top.
Yeah, that's true. That would be great. I mean, we're the Edmonton Interfaith Center for Education and Action. Education is a huge part of what we do, very important. You mentioned Habitat for Humanity, and I was part of a build a couple of weeks ago, but it happened to be the Jewish community and people from the Islamic Family and Social Services.
Well, because they have their interfaith event on right now. We just couldn't get in on time, but we're usually part of that. That's usually when we do our thing.
And the Jewish community, this was the first time we've had sort of an organized presence. A lot of Jews partake as individuals, but this is more the sort of thing that we like to foster because, again, it shows the good side of religion as you're showing the positive side of atheism.
I was on the news a couple of months ago holding hands with people outside of the, the group of terrorists went into the mosque.
Oh, the MAC.
Interviewed on the news.
That's just great.
Yeah, we had a joke. It was what happens when you put a bunch of Muslims and atheists in the room. And they hug you and hold hands. They have a good time and have conversations.
For what it's worth, early Christians were accused of atheism. They didn't believe in the conventional.
Yes, actually, all religions, if it didn't believe in, a Muslim would call a Christian an atheist, a Christian would call a Hindu an atheist because they don't believe in their same God. Which was where the original use of that word was. Yeah, definitely. So we're all atheists a little bit.
I think they forget that atheism has different kinds of meanings. And we sometimes apply one definition to it, for example, that God is a person who acts and intervenes in an independent sort of way, but there are so many other interpretations.
Right, so that would be the theist, deist, pantheist. You've got all these different types of words for people. A lot of people try to claim Einstein as one of their own, but he certainly fell under the pantheist. So he was a universe is, nature is God kind of view, but not a personal God, not someone that if you prayed to would answer your prayers or a deist maybe believes spark of life happened and then whatever that God was took off and hasn't bothered us since and just left us to our own devices. So that's why I made the distinction at the beginning that a theist would be more a personal God, someone that can intervene.
And I decided to be born a Jew and died a Jew and would never have said he wasn't Jewish, but he would separate that completely. But like many Jews, he did not believe in a God.
Yes.
We have quite a few secular Jews.
Absolutely. And there's no need to really, there are many Jews who don't believe in God. Absolutely.
We are in a very difficult, challenging time in human history when religion is being looked on in a fresh way, probably a very healthy way, in comparison to some of the views that the world itself has had on religion and religions. But what is religion? Can we get along without it? I don't think so.
No.
Because there needs to be something in going on in human life that sets us above what we know to be our great limitations. And religion, I think, is meant, any religion doesn't come off with a name like being Jewish or Anglican or United Church or Mohammedan. It comes off as being anything that will help a person be to and in touch with divinity, not a religious divinity, but a degree of perfection in the state of the world. And I think a lot, I don't believe that there are very many religious orders that have not always had their advocates within that order of stating that they're not perfect, they have contributed both to good and bad. And now we're coming to the point where we are wanting to invest in the good
not by hating the bad, or the bad person, or the bad religion, or the bad anything, but rather moving on.
Learning from our mistakes for the rest of
the
exactly
point. What I would say, that in fact, you are also a part of that same category.
Yes, and that's, I think, why we belong in the conversation. But
so
I guess for me, when I'm sitting listening,
another sister.
When I'm sitting listening, what came to my mind listening to you is, for us, it's probably science that we would hold to help progress the world. And again, though, we have to admit that science has got some stuff wrong and has made some mistakes. Medicine has made a lot of mistakes throughout our history. So yeah, you got to take the bad stuff with the good. You can't say, well, it's perfect to use this way, because none of it is. None of it is. So I agree. And that makes that clear to me what you were trying to say before then. So
yeah.
Science has to have something to measure as well. It'll never encompass that feeling or the intuition that goes into religion. People shy away from that because we Buddhists believe that God can only be, or the truth can only be perceived by your own experience through meditation and
right.
Contemplation. So,
you express a concern for not throwing babies out with bathwater.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I would respectfully suggest that if we don't find a place for a spiritual quality in our overall pattern of living in the world, then we'll be throwing out a very big baby.
And it all depends on what you mean by spiritual as well. Because
exactly.
if you know, what it means to you is different to me. For me,
yeah.
I mean, I can have an awe and a sense of wonder of the, I mean, the universe is huge. And
I'm
always amazed. I mean, when I look at the evidence we've got for evolution, that actually fills me with amazing wonder. And I'm thankful to be here, because look at, I'm the product of how many billions of years of things that had to happen in order for me to be here. That's amazing. But that isn't probably what some people mean when they say spiritual. I don't have any sort of transcendency kind of stuff that some people talk about. I don't understand that. It doesn't register with me. But that doesn't mean that I don't have wonder and awe and amazement and all those other things. A connected, evolution brings me a connection to everything around me. So there is still I don't know how you explain that. What's the word I'm looking for? Because it's not spiritual, but maybe some people do call that spiritual.
A common humanity.
Yeah.
We are all brothers and sisters. Whether you believe in God or not, you should believe that you don't hurt other people. Because we teach our children empathy by saying, how would you feel if someone did that to you?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Your definition of religion leaves out an awful lot of us who believe in God, but as God worked through His Son Jesus and the teachings which Jesus left to us.
So what did you take as my definition of religion? Because I didn't have that one up there. I didn't define religion.
I mean, you're talking about a religion which isn't mine.
Right. So I think the actual definition of religion is just any sort of group that come together that believe in the same thing, but there's a higher power involved.
Well,
is the specific thing. So
that's not the way you were.
Well, but that would be a god, right? Would be the higher power. But that could also mean that you could have other groups that.
It's just the division between what you're thinking and what I live by.
And I think it's your definition of religion is the problem.
I didn't define religion. I didn't actually give a definition of this, so I'm wondering why we're getting this conversation.
If God and we all practice it, then whether you call it religion or not, but when we use the word religion, we start to talk about a code that's written down that our people are obliged to obey.
Right.
And if that's what you mean by religion, then you have a great deal to fight. But actually, if you look at many religions, they don't view their religion in that sense. They've got a communication about love and sharing and doing kindness and living by kindness.
And I agree with you, and I said
and
those
so,
are people we don't have any issues with, so I'm completely fine with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We always end at close to 1 o'clock for people who have to go back to work. We have to leave, but please stay. There's coffee, there's tea.